Okay, guys, by the time I post this, hopefully by the time I post this, it will be March the 10th, and on March the 10th is my birthday, my 18th birthday. Yep, my last week of childhood is being spent well, I guess. Been gaming mostly, trying to ignore as much work as I possibly can, but, yeah, so... In order to celebrate my birthday, I'm going to play Gears of War 2 Horde mode because it's fun. Like always, I've always loved the Gears of War Horde modes. They're always. I think the new Horde for Gears of War 4 is really good, even though it uses Gears of War Judgment class, the class-based system from Gears of War Judgment, but it's still good. As long as I get the opportunity to use the Nashor and the Lancer, it's all good. So I'll just keep going until I die, and hopefully I don't die in the first 5 rounds, because I have a habit of doing that. If I make it to round 10, I'll be honestly achieved. I'll be happy with myself. No way. Chain. Eat the chain of the saw. Ah, you bastard. Oh, shit. It shot me in the ass. Once more with feeling. Damn it. God damn it. Gotcha. It's some ammo. About to hurt this guy. Whoa. No. Stay dead. Yeah, all the blood and all the glorious blood and gore in this game. It's magnificent. I also like the soundtrack to Gears of War 2. It's a really good soundtrack. Sets up a really good sound for it. And it's like, playing Horde mode, and then you get through a round, and you just hear the glorious music, it's like, hell yeah. By far the best of the Gears soundtracks, even though I do like the one for Gears 4, because one thing, it's the guy from Game of Thrones, the guy who makes music for Game of Thrones, he does a pretty good job at it. And get chained again. Oh wow. No, get away. Crap. No. Really? I tried to get out of the way and I can't do anything. I suck. Yeah, I tell myself don't die on the first few freaking waves. And what do? You die in the first few freaking waves. You literally die in the second wave. Like, how autistic can you get, Cordell? How retarded can you get? And you are normal. But getting to a good spot, you can take these guys out no problem. Swept your legs out from under you. Now, if only I could grab him. At least he could get a headshot. Oh, whoa. Ooh, get ready. Oh my god. fucking boomers suck.
Nice.
Eat that tree. Eat that chain too. Lancer for you, Lancer for you, Lancer for you, Lancer for everybody. Like an Oprah episode. Right in the ass. Gotcha, headshot. Yuck. Yeah, I guarantee you, if that stuff was happening in real life and you had chainsaws for bayonets, everybody be getting some type of bloodborne disease. Dirty, dirty hole. Get wrecked by Walkus Phoenix. Go get that ammo crate. Oh. Oh wow. It didn't even look like I hit him. Ow. Sniper. I'm retarded. I chunked both my grenades. Because I'm a fool. A damned fool. But I managed to get the flame grenadier with the first one, so that's a plus. Damn it. Like, I love the bolt top, but it's a severe disadvantage in the original games. It's a really slow firing rate. I don't know how many times I've been in a situation where I needed the power, and I needed it stopping power, and I kept getting killed because it couldn't fire fast enough. Come on, man. Oh. Yeah, gotta get away, that's fire. Fire bad. Crap, I'm screwed, aren't I? Or not. Oh well. Yeah, not dying so easily this time around, grubs. Nobody. No. I feel the rumbling in my controller. The bastards are coming. Hell. Get wrecked. Yeah, explode. Yeah, son of a bitch. Damn it. Sniper. Crip stop.
I'll take this.
I'm only doing this to get rid of that guy. He's dead. Damn it. Where's my shotgun? Whoa, whoa, whoa. Shit. Come on, really? Am I gonna suck this bad? I'm already 10 minutes into the video, there's no going back. Like, there's no restarting this. I'm not restarting the whole wave. Son of a bitch. Ooh. Nine.
I'll take this.
Broken pistol. One good thing about using sidearms in this in the Gears games is that is it zoom. The zoom's very handy. This pistol's OP, but like it said, low fire rate. Even though it has a burst. But even though it's a burst fire gun, it's the fire rate's very low. Which makes no sense to me. Chunk the smokes. What am I doing? Get wrecked by flame. Whoa. Big mistake. Jesus, I am just terrible. I suck. Yeah. A great person. This is turning out to be. I think I'm just gonna camp. It's a legitimate trade. No, I'm not gonna camp. I could have used the mortar. I don't have any time. Mortars are very handy. Oh shit. You fucking care. What? What the fuck is this bullshit? Once again, I'm just getting caught. And I need to keep better. I need to look at my surroundings better, because I suck at it. Distraction to grab some frags.
Oh, hi there.
Yeah, there's a hunter abalone. Well, I should want to hear some hunter abalone. Actually, I'm gonna do that. Hold on a sec. Yeah, I think I just about got it.
Twitter, so I can tweet a nice, happy tweet about butterflies, rainbows, and how gay people are the best. All over Twitter.
Comment Twitter. Grinder? Shit.
But that tweet has been there for like a week and a half now, and I have just yeah, but I triggered Jack.
Hold on.
Another reason I thought I may have been suspended is something to do with Riley Dennis. Now, I have no actual...
Oh yeah, Riley Dennis is a retard. He's saying that now.
It just seems a little bit odd, and let me explain why. Riley Dennis was recently verified on Twitter.
What?
Meanwhile, I have twice the amount of followers. So, obviously, Twitter favors Riley Dennis because he's that little SJW turd that they just absolutely adore. The day before I was suspended, I tweeted out two tweets about Riley Dennis. One, saying that after I write CNN or whatever, I'm going to come after Riley Dennis. And then another one saying that I'm going to wear his belt in my life, destroy him. Of course, not meaning actual violence or anything like that. I was seriously just referring to destroy his biggest
Gotcha. Fuck.
Upset or something, but again, I had no proof of that. It was just an idea. Maybe I was suspended because I'm conservative and because of my multiple pro-Trump anti-Islam tweets. This might seem like a conspiracy, but believe it or not, there's actually a lot of speculation on Twitter's right-wing conservatives. For example, back in February, an inside source confirmed that Twitter was shadow banning politically inconvenient users. The source was backed up by a senior editor at a major digital publisher. And then just back in November, Twitter started to suspend alt-right accounts. So maybe I'm considered alt-right for whatever reason, even though I am certainly not alt-right.
Well, you don't post Pepe the Frog memes, do you?
Associated with an alt-right movement, the same day the social media service said it would crack down on hate speech. Alright, well, most people know
hate speech.
But the problem is that this little fag called Jack considers that hate speech.
Gotcha.
So yeah, maybe I'm...
There we go, finally out of this wave. Yeah, no, I'm going to wave 10. It doesn't matter anymore. Not like Milo.
It's also important to remember that Twitter is a privately owned company. So technically, they're legally allowed to suspend any accounts based on any reason they deem appropriate.
However, which is true.
Legal doesn't really make it right. Listen, if I broke the Twitter rules, then okay, I broke the rules. Kick me out, ban me forever, whatever, I don't really care all that much. But at least tell me what I did wrong. At least tell me why I'm getting suspended. And to be totally honest, I don't think I did anything wrong at all. Twitter either doesn't like me, or is all the same. For now, you guys can follow my second backup account. It's @realhunterA. And also do me a favor, tweet at Jack.
Gotcha. Damn it.
Get a little hashtag trending, guys. I'll see you guys all later. Go on the tweet.
Yes. He's playing the sad music. Wow. Killed each other. I thought it only happened in Halo. Yeah. You know what? We'll stop it here. At least we'll stop this section of it here. So what should I play next? Alright, I figured out what I want to play now. And it is... NASCAR! I'm gonna play some NASCAR.
I'm listening to some Ben Shapiro Thuglife. Because Thuglife chose me.
At least it chose him, not me.
Chose me.
The Thuglife chose me. Because the Thuglife is the Thuglife. Yes.
What pronoun? I like this.
And if there's anybody who's inevitably from us to go more further, it is you, because it's your policies which have emboldened from us. They know that people like you are going to get on American television and talk about how the Palestinians are meat victims, and whenever they fire rockets, it can be justified by Israeli policy. From us, all right.
Sometimes it gets so loud, and I don't want it to be. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 400. When did that happen? Mm-hmm. Let's do Pocono.
This track's pretty interesting to race at.
On your own.
Okay. Alright, hold on a sec. I think I get the setup I want now.
You don't know what you're talking about. You're not educated on genetics.
Alright, let's race. Oh shit. I'm an idiot.
In your video where you debunk white privilege, you talk about how white
privilege. Actually, I think I want to restart that. Yeah, let's restart that. Because I screwed that up.
Elaborate on some of the privileges that you think minority groups have.
Okay, so in privileges and law, so when I say privilege, I'm actually going to talk about legal standards.
Drive. Drive, Tony.
Some prime mortgage is designed to appeal to minority
loans,
minority
recipients. Well, I'm stuck.
Without proper qualifications, that is a privilege.
Those are a couple examples. Get out of the way. The mechanics of this NASCAR are so much different from all the other ones, so I still have trouble with the braking. It's hard. Super speed boost away.
Get a lower score on the SAT than the Asian guy who's living in exactly the same circumstance. He gets penalized 50 points, you get 230 points on the SATs. That is definitionally. Do you disagree?
Yeah, but I don't want to take up too much time, so I'm just going to let
And that crappy top face, but it's good for this video because it's the Thug Life. Driving away.
Should Comey have dropped this bombshell? Well, he had no other choice after killing the private server investigation for political reasons back in July. If he'd waited 2 weeks to drop this information, people would rightly have said he stopped the investigation back in July for Hillary and started up again after her election.
Well, that sucks.
Now Hillary's got troubles, and it sure is sweet. I'm Ben Shapiro. This is The Ben Shapiro Show.
It's the one and only deal, Double G, Duke Dog.
Alrighty. Okay, so, here we are. Happy Halloween to everyone.
Almost there.
According to Pew Research, the net worth of white families in 2013 was $141,000.
Right,
for black families, it was $11,000, even less than the $19,000 it was in 2007. According to economist Edward Wolfe of the University of New York, excluding vehicles and other durables, the median black family worth is just $1,700, while 40% of black families have zero or negative wealth. White family worth, in terms of financial worth, is 69 times more than that of black families. Given this disparity, how can you argue that racism is not a driving factor in income inequality?
Because it has nothing to do with race and everything to do with culture. And when you have a culture that doesn't...
He's back to school, so... Oh, shit.
You know what? Explain to me why black kids aren't graduating high school. Explain to me why black kids are shooting each other in rates significantly higher than whites are shooting each other. Explain to me why 13% of the population is responsible for 50% of the murder. Explain to me why the number of black kids in prison, not for innocent reasons, not for walking down the street and getting pulled into a prison, is so high. Explain, if it has nothing to do with culture, explain to me why the single motherhood rate in the black community jumped from 20% to 70%.
Look at that gap.
The same course of time the civil rights movement has made such tremendous strides. Is America more racist now than it was in 1960? And if it is, please explain to me how that happened.
Turn down for weed. I'm a baller.
Your baby!
Ben Shapiro flipping everybody off. That's a sight to see.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is the best one.
The baby is not part of your body. The baby is your baby. Really, my wife is pregnant right now, and she's 30 weeks pregnant. That baby is taking root from the living ground. Okay, that is a living human being in there. Okay, and I promise you, it is not a vulnerable cell. I can guarantee you it's not a vulnerable cell. Because that is a baby. Okay, and I'm sorry, but you're technically a vulnerable cell, but that's a vulnerable cell.
Oh yeah, that one was pretty good. Hold on a sec, buddy. Oh yeah, Ben Shapiro. Yeah, he is my hero.
A lifetime as a male in a certain kind of male. Versus, did she deserve this award? Listen, awards, what are awards, everybody, except opportunity to catch some eyes.
Especially the
ESPN, well done, you see, they did exactly what their job was, to attract eyes, they did it, that's what awards
are made for.
But in terms of the science behind gender dysphoria, you're very familiar with that, so
very familiar.
It's not about the chromosome. Excuse me, the chromosomes within
we
our
both know
nuclei. Yeah,
chromosomes don't necessarily mean you're male or female.
Gender.
Retarded.
Gender identity. Go ahead.
But even so, anything like Klinefelter's
syndrome. Last group that up.
So you don't know what you're talking about. You're not educated on genetics.
Your genetics.
Genetics and back to the brain scans.
You cut that out now, or you'll go home in the ambulance.
Oh,
that
shit.
That's mildly inappropriate for a political discussion.
You know, honestly, Pierce,
you've kind of been a bully on this issue. Because what you do, and I've seen it repeatedly on your show, I watch your show, and I've seen it repeatedly, what you tend to do is you tend to demonize people who differ from you politically by standing on the graves of the children of Sandy Hook, saying they don't seem to care enough about the dead kids. If they cared more about the dead kids, they would agree with you on policy. I think we can have a rational political conversation about balancing rights and risks and rewards of all of these different policies, but I don't think that what we need to do is demonize people on the other side as being unfeeling about the about what happened in Sandy Hook.
How dare you accuse me of standing on the graves of children's
dead? I've seen you do it repeatedly, sir.
Like I say, how dare you?
I've been awarded a video.
I mean, you can keep saying
cool.
that, but you've done it repeatedly.
Is it porn?
What you
I'm kidding.
I've seen you on the program. Is you keep saying to folks that if they disagree with you politically, then somehow this is a violation of what happened in Sandy Hook. And you get, I'd really like to hear your policy prescriptions for what we should do about guns. Because you say that you respect the Second Amendment, and you know, I brought this here for you so that you can read it, Constitution. And I would really like for you to explain to me what you would do about guns that would have prevented what happened in Sandy Hook.
The Thug Life chose him. Clearly. Alright, we're about 20 minutes, almost 30 minutes into this video, so we'll do this last race and we'll finish this video out, and then we'll get out of your hair. I'll get out of your hair.
Well, I'm not the selectively offended get to run the rest of the country. I mean, this is what we are creating. We are creating a society of panty-waist fascists. What we are creating is a group of people who are oversensitive to everything and that are willing to call the cops as soon as they are offended. It's actually it's a violation of the First Amendment, which you saw with a professor from the Mass Communications Department at Missouri telling reporters that they have no right to be there, and at Yale you have students shouting people down. If this is the climate that we're supposed to create, if this is supposed to create openness and tolerance on the campus, I'm missing the openness and tolerance, and let's call the police if I'm mildly offended because my feelings have been hurt. I mean, this is creating a country of crazy people. How can you watch this and not go crazy and think that everyone who's involved in it is crazy in the first place? Evidence. All this is screaming and feelings. How about like a shred of evidence, even for the incidents that actually happened at Missouri that drove this... Really? Where was the police report exactly when it came to, for example, the first N-word incident that led off? There was no police report on any of that. And the second incident at the N-word at the University of Missouri, the administration investigated, and the kids under investigation.
Come on,
get going, get going, get out of my way.
Well, first of all, I think that what we're teaching a lot of kids in college is that oversensitivity and perceived victimization is a path toward reward and virtue. That the more you feel as though you're oppressed, the more people are going to sympathize with you and give you what you want. I think that's a bit of a mistake. I think it'd probably be better off just teaching people not to take everything quite so seriously. But, you know, that said, I of course understand the value of words. I just think that I do wonder at University of Wisconsin, they use words like privilege, obviously, and that's obviously a buzzword. Mm-hmm. If you use words like white privilege, which is extraordinarily common on campuses like UW, I would assume that that's okay. But white privilege is a way of shutting down debate from white people, because then the assumption is that if you're white, then you must be somebody who can't speak properly on any other issues except for white people issues. I mean, you need
to call these words.
Yeah, well, how about this? How about we just have an open debate on all of this stuff? And stop attempting to shut down the terminology that's used per se.
Yep, I agree perfectly there.
The second principle that animates the left is group justice rather than individual justice. There's another name for group justice, that's social justice. Social justice, you should understand, is actually evil. Social justice, when people say it, it's an actual evil. Because anytime you put a modifier in front of a term that is apparently good, you turn it into a perversion of itself. So correctness, if you are correct, there's truth and there's something false, you are correct. Once you add political in front of that, you're not talking about truth and falsity anymore. You're talking about if you say the wrong thing, you get shot. Which is why, by the way, political correctness was a term that was coined by Maslow. It was. Political correctness comes straight from the Maoist handbook. And the same thing is true of social justice. Justice is a good. You do something, it's either good or it's bad, and you get what you deserve. That's what justice is. And social in front of it. Because whether you are guilty or whether you are innocent is irrelevant. If you're a member of a group, then you must pay the price for something that you didn't do. Right? Social justice suggests that I, as a supposedly white man, Jews became white people as soon as we became successful in America. I, as a white man, I am responsible for paying slavery reparations, for example, in the name of social justice, even though all of my ancestors were busy getting killed by Cossacks in Russia at the time that slavery was taking place. And less than 5% of white Americans alive today have ancestors who ever held slaves. Every white person in America, though, has to pay because of group justice. How is that just? It's not. But it's group justice. It's social justice. And valuing the collective, valuing people in terms of groups rather than individuals, is how you get to the point where murder in the name of the collective is okay. They don't know you, they don't know anything about you. One of the gals over here, I turned off the mic so you couldn't hear the conversation. I said to her, she's the one who's shouting that you're all white supremacists. I said, you don't know me, you don't know anything about me. How do you know I'm a white supremacist?
Yes.
And she said, well, that's the image you give off. And I said, really? Was it the yarmulke that did it for you? Now, before we talk about,
I win because I'm awesome.
Basically, that inequality between groups is inequity. If there's any sort of inequality between racial groups, that's because something has happened in the United States that is deeply unfair and is currently happening. Not just has happened in the past, but it's happening right now. We are all the beneficiaries of white privilege. We are all the purveyors and propagators, which they don't understand, of white privilege.
Oh, yeah, right? I have no idea.
Now, it is true, before we go any further, that black people in the United States have obviously suffered historic discrimination. It's inarguably true. Of course that's true. It's even true that some people are likely to suffer from the effect of historic discrimination under things like Jim Crow. But that does not mean that black people right now are suffering from institutional discrimination. And historic discrimination does not explain current levels of inequality.
Yep.
It certainly doesn't justify discrimination against white people who had nothing whatsoever to do with Jim Crow. Individuals all over America experience inequality. Some of us are born rich, some of us are born poor, some of us are born smart, some of us are born protesters.
Right? That's a good
nobody
one.
Nobody is capable of righting wrongs three generations ago by penalizing their great-grandchildren. You can't do that. The solution to historic injustice is not modern injustice. Three generations ago, my people were being slaughtered by the millions in Europe, and FDR wouldn't let Jews into the country. That doesn't mean
God.
There's widespread anti-Jewish privilege throughout America that requires restitution from all of you. That's not how this works. We cannot fix where you started in life. We can't. That's beyond your control. That's beyond my control. But the notion of white privilege suggests you can never, under any circumstances, overcome where you started in life. Because there's this big bear called white privilege that's trying to eat you. And if you make it, even if you make all the right decisions, white privilege will stand in your way. That is a lie. That's, it is a lie that this camp obviously promotes. In general, it turns out there's another reason that in a free country some people fail and some people succeed. Some behavior is better than other values and behavior. And people who tend to hold fast to better values do better than people who don't. Perhaps equality of opportunity only exists so long as people are willing to take advantage of those opportunities. And that's the truth. White privilege isn't reality. It's just a cowardly way to blame somebody else for your own failures to live up to decent standards. Whites are not born with the genetic predisposition to doing the right thing.
Ooh, I can win it.
Arbitrary moral system that benefits whites for doing the right thing. Oh, there are three simple life rules that will guarantee that you are not permanently born in the United States, regardless of race or regardless of gender. Finish high school, get a job, get married before you have babies. That's it.
Yep. That's what you gotta do. I won.
I'm offended by the language of uprising against people who are breaking into other black people's stores and looting them.
This is a lack of values, and people who
are destroying private property, destroying cop cars, and an uprising against what exactly? Against the black police chief, against a mostly minority police force, against the black mayor, against the black president, against the black attorney general, against the entirely, against a city council that is 9 of 15 are black and all 15 are elected Democrats. What is the uprising against? What is it seeking to achieve? I still don't see what exactly the riots are seeking to achieve. Bottom line is, it all can be boiled down to just act like a mensch. Act like a human being. Honestly, it's not useful to riot, it's not useful to break things, it's not useful to throw rocks at people, and the idea that we're supposed to sort of correlate your level of outrage...
I'm going to stick to the 30 seconds.
The last sentence, the idea that we're supposed to correlate your level of outrage... with a certain level of justification. In other words, the more outraged you are and the more angry you are, the more justified you must be, is absolute nonsense.
You're going to have sexist, you're going to have racist, you're going to have all this stuff.
This is the guy that keeps saying fleecing.
Conversation is that there's no solution in simply saying there's racism out there. How does that solve anything? When you talk about there's institutional racism, what does that mean? Show me a law that is racist in intent, and we will agree. Show me a police officer who commits a racist act, like we saw in South Carolina, right, where a police officer shot a black man running away, and was obviously unjustified, and I will agree.
I killed Casey Cannon.
The idea that you can craft a narrative based on no racism because it just must be somewhere out there in the ether, that doesn't solve problems for anybody and creates more problems for people, because now they grow up in a milieu and an environment where they are told that every obstacle they face is from some shadowy, nameless, faceless group who's out to get them simply because of the color of their skin. They'll never succeed in that environment.
How can you argue that racism is not a driving factor in income inequality?
Because it has nothing to do with race and everything to do with culture.
This is still a good one. People like to repeat this one a lot because he spills it out. And they can't respond. If you see the whole thing, they can't respond.
Explain to me why black kids aren't graduating high school. Explain that one to me.
Look at that.
Explain to me why black kids are shooting each other in rates significantly higher than whites are shooting each other. Explain to me why 13% of the population is responsible for 50% of the murder. Explain to me why the number of black kids in prison, not for innocent reasons, not for walking down the street and pulled into a prison, is so high. It has nothing to do with culture. Explain to me why the single mother of the radio black community jumped from 20% to 70% in the same course of time that the civil rights movement has made such tremendous strides. Is America more racist now than it was in 1960? And if it is, please explain to me how that happened.
Last little bit. I win! I win again! Because I'm a murderer. Ooh. 105 on the challenge rater. I'm a beast. Da 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 da. I win. Jews. Nobody likes you. Well, I want to see his video.
So getting into turn one at Atlanta Motor Speedway, pretty wide, and almost feels like you fall down a couple of stories getting into the corner.
I get it. Yeah, zoo tips. Which is pretty good because this game is really freaking hard to play. Like, it is. It's hard. Alright, so, I believe that shall do it for this birthday special of mine. Even though, you know, it's just a birthday special, but yeah. That shall do it for the best.
For my birthday special.
So if you liked my commentary, give it a like and subscribe if you'd like. If you don't, you suck. I'm kidding. And I'll leave you off with this.